Welcome back to the Gift Up Podcast. As promised, 32 burning questions for 32 teams. And we're going to start with Arizona. What's going to happen with Isaiah Simmons now? And that's a good question because I felt like when he was coming into the league, he would have had a lot bigger impact, especially in coverage. I felt like in time he would bulk up and be better against the run. But initially, because he was built like a safety, he would help out in the pass game. And he really just didn't have that big of an impact, period. And then they go and they draft Zaven Collins this year, who's very similar in stature to Isaiah Simmons. Both players very good at the college level, but it's just not looking like it's going to transition to the pros. It's a wait-and-see thing, obviously. We have to see in the preseason, in week one, week two, how Isaiah Simmons looked. Did he put in the work? Are these guys going to bulk up and become better all around? But as a whole, with the Arizona Cardinals, there's a ton of questions, and that's just one of them. You have to look at their secondary. They're depending on Robert Alford. It's really depleted. I would say a bottom five secondary in the league. They're depending on J.J. Watt to reemerge as a dominant player. I think he's still good, but I don't think he's that dominant. Chandler Jones obviously is dominant, but I think their front seven is lacking. And their secondary, like I said, has depth issues. And then offensively, their offensive line is filled with teams' hand-me-downs. And they're also depending on A.J. Green to be a legit number one for them and reemerge. So for me, the Cardinals are just asking too much from the unknown this year. And I think it's going to hurt them. Unfortunately, I have to look at them in more of a negative light. I don't think they're going to be making the playoffs. Moving on now to Atlanta. How is the offense going to look like after the Julio Jones trade? And I don't think it's going to look that good. There are certain elements of the offense that are still decent, like the offensive line is young. They put that together pretty well. Calvin Ridley, as we know, is dominant. But I don't like the fact that they're putting a lot of stock into Kyle Pitts. I don't think he's a generational talent at tight end. I just view him more as a slower wideout. That's what the film showed to me. And he also doesn't go over the middle of the field and take the big hit. So I don't see how he's going to be a safety outlet for Matt Ryan. And I think it's just going to be too easy for teams to double Calvin Ridley and then stack the box. And it's not like they have a dominant running back either. Mike Davis is okay, but he's not a legit 1,000-yard, double-digit touchdown running back. So for me, the Atlanta offense is going to be overly predictable. And then on defense, they're lacking in the front seven, particularly on the defensive line. I think the defensive line is one of the weaker units in the NFL, and the secondary is completely unproven with young faces. So for me, I think Atlanta is going to have a very similar season to what they had last year. I think they're stuck in quicksand right now. Moving over to Baltimore, how did the Ravens diversify their offense? Well, I don't really think they can go any further than what they already have put in place. The offensive line is good. Lamar Jackson is an elite athlete. Mark Andrews is a legit tight end. Hollywood Brown can take the top off the defense. What they really needed to do this offseason to further bolster their team was go after a legit veteran wide receiver. And the pieces that they added, I just don't think are enough. Sammy Watkins is injury prone. You put on the film of Rashad Bateman. He's really just a speedster, a decent route runner, but he's not the kind of guy that's going to go over the middle of the field. He's not going to sacrifice his body, make the tough catch and coverage. So I don't think that they added enough at receiver to get over the hump, to become even more dangerous. Now, mind you, they're still going to be good because they're going to run the read option. J.K. Dobbins is going to get better. Like I said, Lamar Jackson in his own right is an elite athlete. You have to watch him at all times. So because of the read option and everything that branches off of that, they're still going to be dangerous. But I think not adding a veteran wideout, like not making that move for Galladay, things along those lines, I think that's going to hurt them. But they're still going to be a playoff team. Moving over to Buffalo, will they trade for Zach Ertz? Well, Zach Ertz showed up to Philly in camp. There's been no rumblings. That's really quieted down, so I don't think the Bills are going to go after him. It would be nice because tight end on paper is really the only thing the Bills have to fill. But I'm looking at the Bills in a positive light. Do they have a dominant tight end? No, they don't, but they have a good offensive line. They should have a good running back core. A lot of that's going to depend on Zach Moss and if he can become that bruiser for them to back up Singletary. And the receiver position is really good. It's deep. Gabriel Davis really splashed on the scene last year. That's why they felt that they could move on from John Brown. They brought in Emmanuel Sanders, who I think can still be a legit number one, and then Stephon Diggs, one of the better receivers in the game. So the offense, to me, is going to be really good for Buffalo still. The Zach Ertz trade would have been nice, but I don't think it makes or breaks their season. And then defensively, the Bills knew they had to get better against stopping the run and getting to opposing quarterbacks, and they addressed that with their first two picks in the draft, getting Basham and also Gregory Rousseau as well. So everything that the Bills needed to do this offseason, they did. And it's definitely all positives. I think they can get back to a championship game. With Carolina, the question is, does Joe Brady have to become a quarterback whisperer with Sam Darnold? I don't think he does. I'm looking at the Carolina Panthers in a very positive light. They made a lot of good moves this offseason. Are they going to be a 10-11 win team, legit playoff team this year? No, I don't think so. I think they need one more offseason to get to that point. But they're heading in the right direction. I have no complaints about what they've added. And as far as the offense goes, I think Sam Darnold is going to be a lot better than what they've had in recent years. I think people poorly judge him because of his time with the Jets. The Jets had absolutely nothing at receiver, a bunch of number low-end twos and threes, and absolutely nothing on the offensive line and no run game to speak of. So Sam Darnold was pretty much going out there with the Jets and trying to do it all on his own. So I personally think with the supporting cast he has in Carolina, with a deep receiving group, with a decent offensive line, and then a healthy McCaffrey, who's obviously a top three running back in the National Football League, there's going to be a lot of things that open up for Carolina. And we got to remember that too. Last year with Carolina, they were trying to find ways to run the football with DJ Moore. Any way they could try to run the football creatively, Joe Brady was trying to do. And that's what happens when you lose a player like McCaffrey. Because a linebacker or safety has to watch him out of the backfield at all times, on top of the fact that he can hurt you on the ground pretty much any way possible. So just having him on the field is going to make this whole offense look better. And I think Joe Brady did a decent job last year with what he was dealt, with the injuries and a depleted unit. They're just going to keep getting better. All positives on Carolina's side for me. With Chicago, will the Bears instill a second offense? And that's really pointed towards if they start Justin Fields at some point, will they run the read option? And they don't have the offensive line to do that. So I definitely would not do that if I were them. I would put Andy Dalton in there, throw him to the Wolves this year, just accept the fact that you're not going to go to the playoffs this year. Don't ruin Justin Fields now. I think that would be a terrible, terrible mistake. Even if Justin Fields is better than Andy Dalton is right now, I still would wait because they're not deep enough at receiver. Like I said, the offensive line is an issue, and it's not like they have a dominant run game. Montgomery is good, but he's not dominant. So, no, I would not instill a second offense. I would not ruin Justin Fields now. The defense for the Bears, very good in the front seven, very physical. I think the secondary could be a little bit better. That's something they're going to have to address next offseason as well. But unfortunately, I think the offense is going to hold them back, so I have to look at that in a negative light. We saw that last year with the Bears, unfortunately. As physical as that front seven was, come week seven, week eight, they were just mentally zapped because of their offense being pretty much terrible, not being able to move the football, keeping them on the field all the time. And I think the same thing is going to happen this year again, unfortunately. Moving over to Cincinnati, how is their offensive line going to hold up and how are they going to look on the injury front? Well, I still think that they have to add more to the offensive line. I really did like the Jackson Carmen pick. I know a lot of people didn't, but I thought that he has a lot of talent, a lot of promise. So I think he's going to fill one of those positions on the right side. But Riley Reiff is just a stopgap. They still have to prove that they can stay healthy, and they still need more in the interior of that offensive line. So I still think they're a year away from getting to where they need to be there. They're going to be better, but they're not there yet. And as far as the injuries go, there's really nothing that anybody can do about that. Sometimes it's a medical staff problem where they're not doing their job and you have a rampant amount of injuries on your team. That's possible. That could be a little bit better. But for me, it's really about Joe Burrow's health. And we have to see. And he has to prove, can he take a hit in the pocket? Or is he like Nick Foles, you know, you take one strong shot and then you break your arm or you break your leg, tear your ACL, whatever. I hope that Joe Burrow isn't that kind of player, but we still have to wait and see if that's the case. I don't really think there's anything the medical staff can do about somebody if they're just straight up brittle. It's a wait and see thing. I'm personally, yes, I'm very nervous about the injury front for them. Between Joe Mixon and Joe Burrow, because Joe Mixon, I mean, he's been playing, but he's never really been 100% for a full season. So I would like to see that as well. But as of right now, I can't sign off and say the Bengals are going to be a playoff team, but I do think they'll be a little bit better than they were last year. I like their offseason moves. I like the draft. They are heading in the right direction. Moving over to Cleveland, and the question here essentially is, did they fill the need at linebacker through the draft? And I think they did. Between Tony Fields and Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah, they filled the final holes that they needed to fill on defense in the draft. I'm excited. When you look at the Browns from top to bottom, they really don't have any holes left they have to fill. And I think they did enough to beat the Chiefs, to beat the Bills. Yes, I still think it's a coin flip. You know, I think the Bills could beat Cleveland just as easily or vice versa with the Chiefs. But they did enough now. There's no excuses. Like I said, when you talk about the most complete teams in football, Tampa Bay is up there, and Cleveland's right next to there with Buffalo and Kansas City, I think. So all signs are pointing positive for me. I really like what they did in free agency as well, addressing their secondary, getting a lot of good talent there. All positives for Cleveland. Moving over to Dallas, will there be a changing of the guard or the beginning of one at running back? I don't think so just yet. I don't think we would see that probably for another season or two, if it happens at all. But we do have to question Zeke here. Now, we know that he may have had some unknown injuries. We know that that may have been hampering him down a little bit. But unfortunately, I have to question his compassion for the game at this point. And maybe that's me being a little bit snooty, but when Tony Pollard is looking like he's running harder than you on Sundays, I got to question you, because they have a good offensive line. They got weapons at receiver. Yes, Dak did get hurt last year, but still, there's no reason why Zeke shouldn't be able to eat behind that offensive line. So this year, there should be absolutely no excuses for anybody. CeeDee Lamb's getting better. You have Gallup, Amari Cooper, a good offensive line, a good running back core. There's no more excuses for Dak, no more excuses for Zeke. You really can't ask for more of a supporting cast. So I don't think they're going to do anything at running back drastically this year or next year, but all eyes and all the pressure is on Zeke and Dak. And unfortunately, with all the talent with the Cowboys, I still can't get overly excited because of the coaching staff and because of Dak Prescott. I really do feel like they hold the team back. And Dak, to me, is just a stat packer. He doesn't get it done in big-time moments. So until that vision of them changes for me, I can't get excited and say, yeah, they're going to win the NFC East. They're going to win in the playoffs. They're going to go further this year. I can't go that far. They certainly added a lot of talent. And on defense, I really like what they added as far as pass coverage goes. Keanu Neal. Their linebacking core is solid. They added pieces in the secondary in the draft. Joseph, their draft pick, I really, really like that pick. So they're going to be, I think, one of the better teams as far as pass defense goes. The defensive line, I think, could be a little bit better, for sure. Randy Gregory and DeMarcus Lawrence is all right, but I think teams are still going to be able to pound them a little bit. But even with all the talent, Dak and the coaching staff make me second guess it all. Moving over to Denver, how quickly does Teddy Bridgewater move to the front of the pack? Personally, I don't think it matters, because you have to ask yourself the question, how much different is Drew Lock and Teddy Bridgewater? If we're talking about even, let's say, a Madden rating, for instance, they're both probably, what, 72, 73, just to put it in plain layman terms. So I don't think it matters. You want to put Teddy Bridgewater in there. You want to put Drew Lock in there. I think both of those quarterbacks are going to hold this team back from getting to how far they should get, because they had an A-plus draft. They had a really good offseason, and they did everything they needed to do. The offensive line is young and hungry, and they even added to that with Quinn Meinerz. the receiving core, you got three really good quality guys there. Running back core, they added to that this offseason as well. And then defensively, they really beefed up their secondary. The front seven's already good. You have a really good pass rush with Von Miller and Bradley Chubb. But unfortunately, if you don't have a quarterback, you're not going to go that far. And that's what's going to hold them back regardless of what they do there. Going on to Detroit, will we see a drastic shift in Anthony Lynn's offensive identity? Well, I never really thought Anthony Lynn had a particular identity. I don't really think that he does one thing on purpose, like, you know, is he a run-heavy mind or is he a pass-heavy mind? I don't think so. With the Chargers, I felt like they were decently balanced. He let Herbert air it out. When, if anything, before they had Herbert, I would say that he was more of a run-heavy mind. I think by default with the Lions, they're going to have to lean heavily on the run because they don't have a lot at receiver. The offensive line is good but not great. And TJ Hockenson obviously is good, but he's not a great receiving tight end. So I think it's going to be very easy for teams to stack the box, get pressure on the quarterback. Therefore, they're going to have to get creative with DeAndre Swift catching out of the backfield and running the football. That, by default, is going to be what they have to do. And if they can't get the run game going, unfortunately, it's just going to snowball downhill. And like I said, I think it's just going to be overly predictable. So it really, to me, it doesn't matter what offense they put in place. The decision is made for them. And I don't have a lot of high expectations for Detroit this year. I think Dan Campbell, he's going to get his hands in all of this as well. And I don't think he's going to be a very good X's and O's guy. And it's going to hurt Detroit as well as the talent. So I think Detroit's probably going to end up in that 3-5 win range this year. Moving over to Green Bay. What does Matt LaFleur want out of his new defense? Well, this is one of those situations where even though you might change the defensive scheme, I don't think it's going to make that big of a difference when it comes to what the issues are. And the issues are getting to quarterbacks in big time moments, just having an average pass rush. Za'Darius Smith is a really good all-around football player, but he doesn't come up big in big moments. Preston Smith is just average. And they also have a hard time stopping the run as well. They improve the secondary, but I think those problems are still going to plague them up front. I think teams are going to be able to ground and pound on them, and then quarterbacks, for the most part, are going to have a lot of time in the pocket. And that's why one of the reasons why Aaron Rodgers was so unhappy with this offseason. And even heading back a year ago into the draft when they drafted Jordan Love, why not bring more pass rushers in the building? Why not get some linebackers in here that can bang and help stop the run? They didn't address it, and I think in the playoffs, and yes, Green Bay is still going to make the playoffs, they're going to have issues with teams like the Rams, like Tampa Bay. Those same problems are going to rear its ugly head. And I don't think they're going to get past, maybe they get one win in the playoffs, but again, those same problems are going to occur. And then on offense, unfortunately, the offensive line has gotten worse. Bakhtiari, he's not going to start the season healthy either. And they really didn't do anything in the draft to address the offensive line outside of center with Josh Myers. So unfortunately, that's going to be an issue. And I think that's another reason why Aaron Rodgers was unhappy. Moving on now to Houston. Does Tyrod Taylor finally hang on to the quarterback number one spot? Well, first of all, we have to see what happens with Deshaun Watson. We have no idea what the league's going to do to him. We have no idea if the Texans are going to trade him. But all I can say is the Houston Texans are filled with other teams' hand-me-downs, especially on defense. But on offense, the offensive line is, I would say, middle of the pack in the NFL. They did get better with the run game because they added Philip Lindsay, they added Ingram, but they don't have enough at receiver. They just simply don't. And trading for Anthony Miller isn't going to help anything. So with the depleted receiving core, it's just going to be too easy for teams to stack the box, watch the run, watch whatever Tyrod or Deshaun Watson does. And I can speak firsthand about Tyrod Taylor with his time with the Buffalo Bills. If he's your quarterback, if that's what they end up doing, you're going to see a lot of stagnation. You're going to see a lot of three and outs. You're going to see a tired defense that honestly, with talent-wise, they can't afford to be left on the field that long, but they are. That's what you're going to get with Tyrod Taylor. You're not going to get any kind of a godsend with him. And I think, unfortunately for the Texans, they're going to be in the same boat they were in last year. Four to six wins at most. Moving over to Indy, does Frank Reich bring back the essential element for Carson Wentz? Well, with the Carson Wentz injury now, we have to wait and see how many weeks he's going to be out. Looks like he's going to get surgery. So Jacob Eason is going to take the reins. I'm actually a little excited about that he's getting a chance. I know that's really a hipster thing to say on my part, but coming out of college, I was very impressed with his film. I think the year that he came out of college, too, I actually had him ranked as the number two quarterback in that draft. So I'm excited to see what he can do behind this dominant offensive line. But just getting back to the whole thing about coaching with Frank Reich, certainly play calling, he'll help with the play calling, but it's really the offensive line that gives the quarterback confidence. When you're constantly not under pressure and as the weeks go on, you get used to that comfort, that to me is when a quarterback finds its comfort zone. So when and if we see Carson Wentz in the lineup, it's really going to be a matter of him getting the time he had in Philly out of his head, of constantly being under pressure and getting used to this kind of protection here, because Philip Rivers, as we know, was a statue and he had almost perfect protection most of the time. So being that Wentz is a little bit more mobile, he should just be able to utilize that even further. And as the weeks go on, he'll get more comfortable. So I don't really think it has anything to do with Frank Reich as much as it does the offensive line. But unfortunately, with this injury and some of the depth on the defensive side for the Colts, I think right now we have to look at them more in a negative light. And now, instead of winning 12 games, like I projected, 12, 13 wins, it's dropping down into that 8 to 9 win range. So it's a wait-and-see thing right now with Wentz, but it's an unfortunate thing, needless to say. Going over to Jacksonville, what else could the Jaguars do at tight end? Well, to me, that's the last thing I'm concerned about. The Tim Tebow story is great and all, and maybe it'll pan out, maybe it won't. But whether or not the Jags have a good tight end, that's not even an issue. For me, it's how is Trevor Lawrence going to look like in the pocket, under pressure, without the comfort of read option at the college level. So first and foremost, I want to see that. Travis Etienne, is he going to transition to the pros well? Because if he doesn't, they're not going to have that much of a run game. That's huge. They're putting a lot of stock into those two players. And I would say injuries too. You know, just watching that at the receiver position. And Trevor Lawrence, you know, when he starts taking those shots, is he going to be able to hold up? And defensively is another big concern as well. The defensive line, I think, is one of the worst units in the NFL. The linebacking core is okay, not great. And they're not that deep at secondary. So those concerns out-trump anything that has to do with the skill positions. And unfortunately for the Jags, I think it's going to be a really tough season. I personally didn't like the Trevor Lawrence or Travis Etienne pick. I think that 4 to 6 wins, you know, 6 wins maybe being a little bit generous for them this season. Moving over to Kansas City, will the Chiefs ground and pound in 2021? Absolutely, I think they will. Clyde Edwards-Helaire keeps getting better. He just has to stay healthy. And they revamped that offensive line for a reason. To protect Mahomes, absolutely. But also to run the football. And I think that's going to take a lot of pressure off of the quarterback, open things up in the pass game. Teams really aren't going to know what to do. With Andy Reid's expert play calling, with Hardman and Tyreek Hill, you know, having to be double deep, Travis Kelce eating underneath, and then they had a great draft pick with Cornell Powell, who's going to be Sammy Watkins' replacement. I think he's even going to be better. I think teams are going to have a hard time stopping the Chiefs this year. They're just going to be, I think they're going to be even better than they were last year. Plus on defense, that defensive line is looking really good, providing Frank Clark doesn't get suspended. Chris Jones, Frank Clark, Jaron Reed, that sounds pretty dominant to me. All signs pointing up for the Chiefs. They'll be competing for a championship game. Going over to the Raiders, are we done hearing about Marcus Mariota as a comeback candidate? I would hope so, because Derek Carr is simply a better quarterback. can Marcus Mariota come off the bench and wow you with his feet a little bit and surprise a team if they're not ready for him? Sure, but that's as far as it goes with Mariota. Derek Carr is the starting quarterback. My concerns lie elsewhere. My concerns are on the offensive line. Mike Mayock can poo-poo it and say we're cheaper but better on the offensive line. That's a bunch of malarkey. You don't know if Incognito is going to stay healthy. You don't know how Denzel Good is going to pan out. The only thing I can say for sure on the offensive line is they have the tackle positions locked down. Colton Miller on one side, I absolutely love the pick of Leatherwood on the other. So to me, that's set. But the interior of that offensive line is going to hurt Derek Carr. He's going to be under pressure because of it. And it's also going to hurt the run game. So yes, you got Josh Jacobs, you have Kenyon Drake, but I don't think there's going to be that many run lanes blasted open for them. So I think with the receiver position being what it is, not being overly dangerous, you have Darren Waller, who's a dominant tight end, but that's pretty much it. You know, Bryan Edwards, maybe he can come along and be that number one for them, but we didn't really see that last year being didn't come up as a positive. As the season went on, he actually got worse. So I just think the offense is going to be overly predictable. You stack the box, watch Waller. That's pretty much it. You don't have to fear Zay Jones. You don't have to fear Hunter Renfrow. You don't have to fear John Brown. You don't have to double these guys. And then defensively, I think a lot of problems are going to plague the Raiders as well. They did bring Ngakoue and a healthy Crosby. That should be a good pass rush duo. But I still think the interior of that defensive line and the depth of the defensive line is an issue. They don't have anybody physical at the linebacker position, and their secondary isn't that deep. So unfortunately, I think teams are going to be putting up 28 points on them per week. It's going to be easy to score on them. So between the offense being overly predictable and the defense not being physical, I think the same problems are going to plague the Raiders this year. Moving over to the Chargers, what is the Rashawn Slater initiation process like? Well, to me, it's pretty simple. He's going to be the starting left tackle. There should be no qualms about it. You drafted him in the first round. He was a lot of people's number one offensive lineman coming out this year. There really is no initiation process. My concerns with the Chargers are the interior of the offensive line at the guard positions and the injuries. Keenan Allen, Mike Williams, that's one of the best duos in football, but they're never 100% or 90% for that matter. Did they suit up for a lot of games last year? Absolutely, but it's not the same as being 100% healthy. So if they can stay healthy and Eckler is healthy with Jackson, they get the run game going a little bit, the offense should be fairly dangerous. I like what they added at tight end too. Jared Cook with Trey McKitty, that's going to be a threat that other teams have to watch at all times. But I still think they're an offseason away because of that offensive line, because of the defensive line as well. I think that that's a really weak unit. So one more offseason, and then I can sign off on the Chargers being an 11-win range playoff team, but not yet. With the Rams, who's going to emerge at linebacker? I think it's going to be Ernest Jones. I really did like that draft pick, so I think he's going to step right in and be very good for them. The Cam Akers injury is a huge blow for them, because there's a young, hungry player that was running really hard in the playoffs, and you just were hoping that he was going to keep building on that with all the weapons that they have at receiver, and now we're not going to get to see that. So I hope that they make a play for Le'Veon Bell, and who knows, maybe that could even be a little bit more dangerous with Le'Veon Bell being as good of a receiver as he is out of the backfield. Henderson at running back's okay. They're going to be careful with him so he doesn't get hurt. But I really think they need to make a play for a running back. I'm not high on what they have on the roster right now. And I am worried about the defensive depth. Not really worried about the Brockers up front, because I just felt like he was average anyway. But the bottom line is, outside of Aaron Donald on the defensive line, obviously Leonard Floyd rushing the passer is good. But they lack depth in the front seven big time, especially on the defensive line. And then in the secondary, when you lose players like John Johnson, that's going to hurt big time too. So I do think, unfortunately, the defense is going to take a little bit of a step back, especially with the loss of a good mind like Staley. He turned that defense around into the number one unit in 1 year, even though the talent, you know, out of talent last year, but still, coaching has to be given some credit as well. So when you look at everything that they lost as a whole, I do think the defense is going to take a little bit of a step back, but they still have Sean McVay as a head coach. The offense is still going to be very dangerous. They still have Aaron Donald and Jalen Ramsey on defense. So they're still going to be a playoff team, I think. But when you talk about Super Bowl, I can't go that far. I can't go championship game or anything like that. But they will be competing for one. That's for sure. I think they're going to get in the playoffs and be a legit threat. But these things that they lost, I think, are going to hurt them. Moving over to Miami, will the Dolphins at some point look to add another quarterback or make a trade for one? I don't think so. They're really all in on Tua. You have Jacoby Brissett as the backup to school Tua a little bit. And worst case scenario, if things really go south, you can put Brissett in. All eyes are on Tua. There's absolutely no doubt about it. I said this before. I don't think that there's a player with as much pressure on him as Tua. Maybe Dak because of Dallas in the spotlight there. But Miami has so many things in place. And they've built this team up really good the past three seasons. Look at how deep the receiving core is. If everybody's healthy, that receiving core is a top five unit in the NFL. They keep adding to the offensive line. They're going to have a decent run game. But Tua, is he going to revert back to captain checkdown like he did last season? As the year went on, he got worse. I don't know, because to me, that's the only concern. That's the only worry that I have with the Dolphins. If I knew that they had a really good quarterback, I would say they're a 10-plus win team. They're going to the playoffs, no doubt about it. But to me, that's the only concern. And right now, I'm leaning towards Tua being an issue. But we got to see. Let's watch Tua in the preseason. If he can't even move the ball against the twos and threes, then we know there's a problem. So it'll be a problem that's resolved very early that we can spot. We got to pay attention to Tua to see where the Dolphins are going to go this year. Moving over to Minnesota, how do unresolved conflicts at the quarterback position play out? Well, to me, anybody that says the quarterback position for Minnesota is a problem, you haven't been watching them, because Kirk Cousins, when he has a little bit of time, when he has the support of a run game, he's pretty damn good. And I don't know what people are comparing him to right now. Are we comparing him to like Tom Brady or Peyton Manning? Well, no, he's not that, but he's also better than most quarterbacks too. So for me, it's really about health. It's about the offensive line for Minnesota, and it's about coaching. For me, I'm worried about Zimmer because I really felt like his play calling has been diminishing as the years have gone on. I don't trust him, especially with the defensive play calling. And the offensive line for Minnesota. They added Darisaw, but I think they needed to add more, particularly on the interior of that line. And I don't think they got it done. Therefore, it's going to hurt the run game. It's going to hurt Kirk Cousins in the pocket. But is Minnesota still going to be a dangerous football team? Absolutely, because they have star players like Justin Jefferson, Adam Thielen, and Dalvin Cook. Those guys can dominantly take over moments in games. They're going to have that to lean on. But as we know, you win in the trenches, and I don't think their O-line is where it needs to be. I think Minnesota is going to be around that 8-9 win range this year. I still think they need one more offseason to get it right, and I think they need to reevaluate their coaching staff as well. Moving over to New England, what are the Patriots going to do at quarterback? Well, I didn't think the battle was going to start this far, or this quick. But Cam Newton and Mac Jones are going toe-to-toe, and apparently, from what we've been seeing, Mac Jones is looking a little bit better. I personally would like to see Mac Jones sit 1 year, learn the playbook, get comfortable, because you got to figure, the Patriots loaded up really good this offseason. So if you give them one more offseason to really get everything right and then put Mac Jones in after he knows the playbook, knows how things work in the NFL, I think that would be a better avenue for them. But they have to find out too, is Cam Newton going to be a liability? Now, I think it's a little bit unfair to judge Cam Newton from what we saw last year because the supporting cast just simply wasn't there. They really didn't have a run game. The offensive line had some issues. And they obviously didn't have a lot to throw to. But they corrected that this offseason by getting better at tight end, getting better at receiver. They drafted Ramondre Stevenson at running back, so the offense is completely revamped with a lot of speed and a lot of talent. So I think it would be wise to see what Cam Newton can do at least early on. And then if it's really a liability, like if he's being inaccurate, if he's fumbling, throwing footballs into the dirt, then they may be forced to start Mac Jones. And this is a really good situation to compare with Chicago in a sense, because this is a situation where if Mac Jones is ready, if he truly is ready, I wouldn't mind seeing him thrown into the fire because they have a good supporting cast and good coaching. With the Bears, it's not that way with Justin Fields because they don't have a lot at receiver. Like I said, the offensive line is an issue. They don't have a dominant run game. It'd be like asking to ruin a quarterback. But this is a totally different situation. So week three, week four comes around and Cam Newton's blowing games. I wouldn't mind seeing Mac Jones in there. And who knows? Like I said, right now the battle's going on. Mac Jones might even beat out Cam Newton before the season even starts. Moving over to New Orleans, will Taysom Hill look any different after a quarterback-centric offseason? No, he won't. He's a gadget quarterback that is never going to be any more than that. With Jameis Winston, I think you have to put him in week one and then use Taysom Hill as a gadget quarterback behind him. I think that's their best chance to win this season. I really would like to see what Jameis Winston can do with a good offensive line and a run game, because when he was with Tampa Bay, he had all those interceptions because they had absolutely no run game to speak of. And teams knew 90% of the time Jameis Winston was going to drop back to pass. So when it's that easy, when you already know what a team's going to do, it's easy to pick the quarterback off. So with Winston, with his rocket arm, with a little bit of mobility that he has, with Alvin Kamara and Latavius Murray running the football, I want to see it. And I think a lot of fans were cheated out of seeing it in that Tampa Bay playoff game because Drew Brees said he played through multiple injuries, and that's just selfish. That's completely selfish. He should have sat himself down and said, Jameis Winston gives us a better chance to win. But he didn't do that, and he cheated a lot of hardworking Saints players and a lot of Saints fans out of a possible championship. That's straight up truth. So I hope that the Saints don't make the same mistake twice and put Taysom Hill in there this year, because it will be the same thing we saw last year. Losing to a team like the Eagles when you have no business losing to them, when you have enough talent to beat them, simply because Taysom Hill is stagnation city. So for me, Winston, starter, and unfortunately the Michael Thomas news isn't helping anything. The fact that he's not going to be ready until week 7, they really don't have a whole lot at receiver outside of him. So unfortunately, regardless of who starts at quarterback, I think the offense is going to be overly predictable. Teams are going to know that they have to just stop Kamara first. There's no receiver that they have to double on the team. It's going to hurt them, plus the pieces that they lost on defense. I think the defense is still okay, but I don't think it's going to be as good as it was last year. So unfortunately, for a team in New Orleans that's used to getting double-digit wins, I think that they're going to be in that 7-8 win range this year, unfortunately. Moving over to the Giants, can the offensive line support their grand visions? I don't think so. Their offensive line isn't where it needs to be yet. Right tackle is a big issue. The interior of their offensive line is an issue as well. So for me, you got Daniel Jones, who I really like. I think he's a definite good quarterback. I don't have to second guess that. He's a playmaker. Saquon, if he can stay healthy, you'll have a top 10 run game. At receiver with Kadarius Toney, with Shepard, and also with Galladay, you've got more than enough weapons. You count in Ingram at tight end as well. I have no doubt that they're going to be able to make plays, air it out. But I do think that, unfortunately, Daniel Jones is going to be under more pressure than he needs to be. And I don't think that we're going to be seeing those run lanes blasted open for Saquon. So they're still going to be dangerous because of all the playmakers they have, but I don't think it's going to be consistent because I think they're still an offseason away from getting the offensive line right. And defensively, I also think they're not deep enough on multiple levels. There was some picks that I liked this year in the draft, but I still think they're not deep enough in the secondary. We don't even know if Adoree Jackson can stay healthy for a season. And then on the defensive line, I don't think they're deep enough either. You lose Dalvin Tomlinson, that's going to hurt. So Giants have gotten a little bit better, but they're still a little ways away from being a playoff team. The Jets are up next. What will the offense look like this year? Well, I think they have to run the football. Very similar to what Detroit is going to have to do. Because they don't have a dominant threat at receiver, and they overpaid for players like Corey Davis. To me, he's just a number two. He's not somebody that has to be doubled every snap. Crowder is okay, but he's just a speedster. Again, somebody that doesn't have to be doubled. So I think it's just going to be way too easy for teams to key in on the run and pressure Zach Wilson. Their offensive line isn't deep. It's got a lot of issues still. So I think by default, that offense is going to have to lean heavily on Michael Carter and then go from there. Zach Wilson with a little play action, try to get him some comfort level and go from there. And we don't even know if Zach Wilson is going to pan out. There was an argument with the contract. They didn't want to guarantee him a certain amount of money in a certain amount of time. And you can only imagine that's because they feel like he might be a bust. I certainly do. Because he's not going to get the same luxury that he did in college. You watched his highlights in college. I mean, it's like he was standing back 5 feet from the offensive line and it was just a wall. He was never under pressure. And then the one game where he was somewhat under pressure with Coastal Carolina, they lost. So I can only go off the facts. So I want to see what he can do under pressure. And then defensively for the Jets, a lot of issues as well. Secondary issues, front seven issues as well. They're depending on players like Jared Davis. Okay, he hasn't been good since 2018, so all of a sudden we're just supposed to think he's going to be a legit number one linebacker. Sheldon Rankins on the defensive line, torn ACLs in both legs. We're just supposed to believe that he's going to stay healthy a full season. I think they're going to have a lot of issues, and we don't even know how committed C.J. Mosley is either. He hasn't even played in 2 years between injuries and the COVID opt-out. Good luck with the Jets. I think they're going to be a three to four win team. Moving over to Philadelphia, what is the near future plan at quarterback? Well, it's got to be Jalen Hurts. I think with where you drafted him a year before, everything that's, you know, the trade with Carson Wentz, it's all been mounting towards Jalen Hurts taking the reins. And I'm actually very optimistic about this offense. If healthy, that offensive line is looking really good. I think it could be a top five offensive line. They got better at receiver. You got Devonta Smith in the draft, obviously. I think he's going to be really good for them. A legit route-running possession receiver that you can count on. Off of play action, I think he's going to be deadly. And then Rieger, I think, is going to keep getting better as their number two. And then Foljam as a number three isn't bad. And, of course, Zach Ertz is looking like he's going to stay in Philly. There you go. That offense is looking pretty damn good. Now, we do know that there is rumblings that Philly wants to trade for Deshaun Watson, and I would be all for that if they could get that done and if he plays, you know, if they don't suspend him. So that would be great. And then that offense, I think, could catapult into the top five offenses in the league if they made a move like that. I'm very optimistic about their offense, but their defense, not so much. The defensive line is getting older. And players like Fletcher Cox, they're not what they used to be. Are they still good? Yes, but they're not dominant. At least I don't think so. The linebacking core, they did get Eric Wilson from Minnesota, but I still think that that lacks some depth. And then the secondary has a lot of issues too. Darius Slay is good. There's no doubt about that. I like the Anthony Harris pick at safety, but it's not deep enough. So I think the defense is going to hurt Philly this year, as it did last year. But offensively, they're heading in the right direction as a whole, as a team. But it's going to take an offseason or two to get it right. Moving over to Pittsburgh, is Ben Roethlisberger's successor on the roster? Absolutely not. Mason Rudolph will never be a legit number one quarterback. Neither will Dwayne Haskins. Good backups. If Berger had to come out for, you know, rest for one game or gets a little nicked up in a game, sure, they could go in there and possibly scrap a win. But that's as far as I can go with that. And unfortunately for the Steelers, I think the same problems are going to arise this year that did last year because they just simply didn't address it. The offensive line is looking like one of the worst units in the NFL. And Berger, the fact that he's older and injury prone, come week 10, 11, 12, I think he's going to wear down again like he did last year. You can make excuses. You can talk about him slimming down, taking this offseason more serious, but it's all just offseason banter. Bottom line is Father Time is undefeated, and I think those same problems are going to arise for Pittsburgh this year. They could make the playoffs. You know, they could get a wild card spot, I think, but I don't think it's going to go beyond that. I don't think they're going to be able to get a playoff victory because of those issues. Moving over to San Francisco, when will the Brandon Ayuk hype train leave the station? Well, I don't think it needs to. I think it already has. Brandon Ayuk, in my opinion, is a really good receiver. He just has to stay healthy. And that goes for the entire 49ers team. From the defensive side to the offensive side, they have got to remain healthy. Shanahan is an expert play caller. So they get the play action going, get the run game going. Kittle and Ayuk are going to be open and they're going to eat. I can't say that the 49ers are going to get to a Super Bowl or anything like that this year because I do think they need to add more depth on both sides of the football. But they are going to be a legit threat. They're going to be a good football team. I liked what they did in the draft. That Aaron Banks pick was huge. I think he's going to be blasting open run lanes, and that just goes right into Shanahan's playbook and what he likes to do running the football. So all signs pointing up for San Francisco. I just feel like they're another season away from adding more talent on the defensive side and finishing up the offensive line, getting that right. Moving on to Seattle, are we ready to believe in another high upside signing in the secondary? Well, I don't really think there's that much left they can do. Obviously, they took a big hit on defense this year. They lost Jaron Reed. The secondary, I think, is going to have its issues. It's not very deep. And the linebacking core is up in the air, too. I mean, we know Wagner's going to be there, but they don't know what they want to do with K.J. Wright. So there's only so much that Seattle can overcome. Pete Carroll has coached this team up and done more with less through the years. Russell Wilson, obviously, has kept this team afloat through multiple injuries. But I do think defensively it's going to catch up with them this year. And I don't think they're going to be as dominant. I think that it's going to be easy for teams to put up points on them. And I think it's going to hurt them. From an offensive perspective, I think it's pretty simple. Chris Carson just has to stay healthy. Because, see, I think he's a legit top 10 back in this league. But it can't just be all Russell Wilson all the time. Teams last year, because Chris Carson wasn't fully healthy, he may have suited up for some games, but he wasn't 100%. It was too easy for teams to just watch Russell and what he was going to do. It was hard for Seattle to put up points. So Chris Carson stays healthy with what they added in the draft too. Getting Dwayne Eskridge, I think that's going to be a big help to them. I think that's going to free up Metcalf and Lockett a lot. Dwayne Eskridge, I think you got to double him. You got to keep a safety watching him at all times. He is that big of a legit deep threat. And I think, again, health-wise, everything works out. Seattle's offense is going to be looking good. But the defense, especially when we don't even know what's going on with Aldon Smith, there's way too many questions, and there's only so much that you can overcome. Going on to Tampa Bay, does the offense now begin as Tom Brady's week one? Absolutely. Last year, we had to wait. You know, it was a rocky start. But as the season went on, they started to gel. The chemistry got better. And they're not going to have the same hurdles that they did last year. Obviously, Godwin with that hand injury, he's going to be fully healthy. Mike Evans was hobbled last year by multiple injuries. He'll be ready to go. And I think they're just going to pick up where they left off in the Super Bowl. Gelling, looking good. And what's even more dangerous about it is the fact that Ronald Jones kept getting better at running back. So Brady's going to have that play action, and he's going to have Antonio Brown, Gronk, Evans, Godwin. It's going to be ridiculous. So yes, week one, that offense is Tom Brady's, and it's going to be looking good. And then defensively, they're stacked too. That's why earlier when I talked about Cleveland, when you talk about the deepest teams in the NFL, Tampa's number one. Moving on to Tennessee, what happens to the Titans' offensive line? Well, I like it. I don't have any issues with it. I think they're going to be good, personally. With Julio Jones in the fold, providing that he doesn't get suspended for the illegal sale of marijuana. I mean, when you're a millionaire already, why are you doing stuff like that? Even though morally okay, It's not that big of a deal. It's not really hurting anybody. But why even risk it? I know money is good, but if you're already a millionaire, man, I mean, come on. There's got to be some limitations to that. But providing that he doesn't get suspended, you have arguably the best duo at receiver in the NFL with A.J. Brown and Julio Jones. I like the offensive line. Derrick Henry, you could argue he's still the best running back in the National Football League. I think the offense is going to be looking really good. And not as much pressure because of the Julio Jones acquisition is going to be put on the offensive line. And then defensively, I really like their front seven, what they added. That's going to be physical. Vrabel, he coaches up that defense pretty good. Tennessee is going to be in the mix for an AFC championship game. They're going to be a threat to Buffalo. They're going to be a threat to Kansas City. They're going to be a threat to the Browns. That's my opinion. Going over to Washington, what is Washington going to look like offensively? Well, I'm excited about Ryan Fitzpatrick starting. I'm also excited about the fact that they can have a legit battle, too. I mean, most likely Ryan Fitzpatrick will be the starter, but at least this gives them a chance to measure Heinicke. We saw some flashes in that Tampa Bay game. We still really don't know what they have with him just yet. But again, with Fitzpatrick side by side with him through training camp and in the preseason, they can really gauge where he's at. And if Heinicke ends up being better, then it's a luxury that you have. Great. If not, then you got the safety outlet with Ryan Fitzpatrick. They're young and good at receiver. I like what they have there. I like Gibson at running back. But what's going to hurt them is the offensive line. To me, it's not, I don't even think it's middle of the pack. I think it's towards the bottom tier in the NFL. So whoever's going to be quarterback is going to be under pressure. And obviously the run lanes aren't going to be opened up. The defense is definitely going to keep this team afloat. I think this defense could be a top five unit, obviously led by that mammoth defensive line and Ron Rivera's coaching. But unfortunately for Washington, that offensive line is going to hurt them big time. And I think you're talking 7-8 wins for them this year. It's going to take another offseason to really get the quarterback position right and fix the offensive line. And that's all 32, guys. I start my job tomorrow. So during the week, you're probably not going to hear too much from me. I will try my best to get a podcast up either Friday nights or Saturdays. What I'm going to do during the preseason is when I'm home on the weekends, I'm going to watch some game film, let you guys know what I'm seeing, like Zach Wilson, Tua, all those questions that we talked about in this podcast. Those are what I'm going to try to answer during the preseason so we can get a good read on these teams before we start making our bets. And then when the season starts, I'm going to be doing the picks probably every Saturday. Saturdays are going to be the day right before NFL weekend, right before Sunday, that I'm going to be able to do the spread videos, the over-unders. I'll get as much done as my mind will possibly let me do. And that's how it'll go through September. And then in October, I'll be stationed somewhere. I should be back home. Then the schedule will be the same. I can get the picks up a little bit earlier in the week, and then I can get every video up. Because, I want to do my parlay videos, the teaser videos, and all that. For the start of it, though, it may only be the picks. But again, I don't know. I mean, I'll get as much done as I can. I don't know how tired I'm going to be. I don't know how I'm going to feel. But that's the plan. So again, the picks are going to be coming the day before NFL Sunday on Saturday. So it'll be there for you guys, but you're going to have to wait to make your bets or picks if you do want to see what I have to say about that. So with that, make sure to hit the like button, share the videos, and subscribe.